Thank you, Father. Holy Spirit, we thank you for teaching us your word, for helping us to understand the authority that you have given us. We thank you, Lord, for making this teaching so very simple, easy, and practical. Holy Spirit, you take control over this session. Help us, Lord, to realize who we are in Christ, knowing our real identity, understanding the love that you have for us and the authority that you have given us in your name to cast out demons, to pray in new tongues, and to heal the sick in your name, Lord. Thank you, Holy Spirit. Thank you, Abba Father. Lord, as your word is preached, we thank you for confirming every word of yours with signs accompanying. In Jesus' name we pray, Father. Amen. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. Praise you, Jesus. Hallelujah. Today we learned something very, very important, very, very basic. Yes, this authority is given to us, and this authority is the same authority that Jesus had, is given to us. Before going into that, when God created man, God created man in his own image and likeness. And God told man, let them have dominion. Correct? Let them have dominion. Now, is this dominion given to man or given to devil? Really?
Yes.
Okay, during the break and even during the session, the questions, it looks like somehow we look at the devil more powerful. And I like your honest, you honestly spoke how scared you were when the person began to manifest. Now, this happens very common. She openly spoke, we did not say, that's the difference. Correct? Especially when we see somebody manifesting, somebody, you know, eyes popped, screaming, immediately fear comes, right?
Yes.
Somehow, there is a fear that this demonic power is more powerful than me. Yes or no?
Yes.
Now, every time there is fear, there is a lie. Because the Bible says in 2 Timothy 1:7, God has not given us the spirit of fear, but of power, love, and sound mind. Correct? So if God did not give me fear, that means this fear did not come from God, and this fear is not just an emotion. The emotion is a reaction or a response, but actually fear is a spirit. If this spirit did not come from God, then it came from outside. It comes from the enemy. It's a demonic spirit. This fear has no access in my life without a lie. If I see fear, any fear, now even the fear of demons, fear of people manifesting, fear of, you know, if I cast out, the demon might come in me, is because there is a lie in us. The devil cannot have any control in our life without our cooperation. The devil has no control in our life without our cooperation. We had to yield to him. We have to cooperate with him. Another way to say, we have to agree to that lie or believe the lie. Only then he can have access in our life. That's why he was saying, does the devil have any other method? No. The only method he uses is what? Deception. Lies. Hallelujah. And one of the lies of the devil is, the devil is very powerful. No, that is a lie. What is a lie? Anything contradicting to the truth is a lie. Now, what does the truth say? The one who's in me is greater than the one who's in the world. And the devil has convinced you that he is more powerful. That's why there is fear. The good news is we all can overcome this fear. Because the Bible says we overcome evil with good. And we all can come to a place just like Jesus, because Jesus said, those who believe in me will do the same works I did and even greater works than this, because I go to my Father. Jesus will never tell us to do something when he has not equipped us to do something. That means we all can come to a place where we can cast out demon without fear. But how do I overcome evil? With good. Now, when God created man, God created man in his own image and likeness. And God gave man dominion to rule over this planet Earth. Now, we were created just like God, but our rulership is limited only to this planet Earth. Correct? That's why Psalms 115 verse number 16 says, can someone read Psalms 115 verse number 16? Can you read in NRSV?
Heaven belongs to the Lord alone. But he gave the earth to the human race.
NRSV says human being. Now, heaven belongs to God alone. Good news is God alone. Heaven belongs to God. But the earth he has given to human race or human being. Correct? So whom did he give authority? Or whom did he give dominion to rule over this planet Earth? To us or to Lucifer? So who is given the dominion to rule over this earth? Any person in this planet Earth, to have access in this planet Earth, needs a earth suit called body. Any person. Now, for example, Paul, even today, is there. But he is in the presence of God. Correct?
Yeah.
But can he have access in this planet Earth?
No.
Now, can Moses have access in this planet Earth? Why? Only a person who has the earth suit called a body has access in this planet Earth. For example, even Jesus, the Bible says, in the beginning was the Word. The Word was with God. The Word was God. And that Word became flesh. So the Creator who created us, that created the heavens and the earth, even he took enter into this world, he needed a body. Yes or no?
Yes.
Now, even God, to come into this planet Earth and to have access in this planet Earth, he needed a body. That's why he needed the cooperation of Mother Mary to agree for his will, agree to his word, so that he could receive a body to come into this planet Earth. If you see, today morning we saw Hebrews 1:3, correct?
Yes.
Jesus is the perfect, can you read that? Hebrews 1:3, perfect imprint, representative, the exact imprint of the Father's essence. Yeah, can you read, sister? Yeah, 1:3.
Who being the brightness of his glory, and the express image, of his person,
and upholding
all things
all things
by the word
of his power
when he had by himself
purged our sins
sat down at the right hand
of the majesty
on high.
Okay, now Jesus is the perfect imprint or expression of the Father. Correct? Yes or no? So when we see Jesus, today morning we saw Jesus did only what he saw and he heard what the Father did. So Jesus is the perfect representation of the Father. So if I want to know how the Father is, all I have to do, is to see Jesus. If I know Jesus, then I know the Father. Because Jesus is the only, I think AMP says, the only representation. The only, there is nobody else. They, before Jesus, you had Moses, you had Abraham, you had Joseph, you had many people, Isaiah, David. But none of them were the perfect imprint or representation of Father. Only Jesus was. That's why he said, I only speak what I hear my Father speak. I only do what I see my Father do. So he is constantly seeing and hearing what the Father is doing. And you can see Jesus speaking and doing what the Father speaks and what the Father does. That means if I want to know who God the Father is, I cannot know who God the Father is through Elijah or Elisha or Moses or none of them are perfectly representing the Father. The only person who is perfectly representing who Father is, that means every other people had some or the other flaw or error. But who is perfect? Jesus. So if I want to know the character of the Father, then I should know him through Jesus. Before Jesus, many man of God and woman of God came. Correct? Abraham, Isaac, Sarah, Ruth, you can, Esther, many, David, many men of God and women of God came. Could God do anything in this planet earth without these men of God and women of God agreeing with his word? That is faith. That's why the Bible says it is impossible to please God without faith. Correct? So could God do anything? Now, when God created man in his own image and likeness. And God gave man dominion. And God also said the earth belongs to man and the heavens belongs to God. That means God will not do anything because he abides by his own words. He will not do anything in this planet earth without a human body. That's why the Bible says that we have to offer ourselves as a living sacrifice. A sacrifice is something that is laid on the altar. But the Bible says in Romans 12:1, we have to offer ourselves as a living sacrifice. That means when I have life, a sacrifice is something that is dead. But still, I choose to put myself to death. Means what? I'm ready to do not what I want to do or not what the worldly desires, but I want to do what God wants me to do. Hallelujah. Stomach is full. Very good, tasty food we had. Yeah, very challenging now. Praise God. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. Praise you, Jesus. That means God cannot do anything in this world without a earth suit called a body. Anything. Even if God wanted to part the Red Sea, he wanted Moses there. Even today, if a blind eyes, God wants to open a blind eyes, He want, now why people are blind? It's not because God wanted them to be blind, because there is no one there to allow God to open the blind eye. Because when God created this earth, He said, this world belongs to you, to man, and the heavens belong to God. That's why in heaven there is no blind people. That's why in heaven there are no demon possessed people. Because who's in charge?
God.
But in this earth, who's in charge?
Yes.
But if we want to see God's power manifest, then we have to yield to the Holy Spirit. That's called prayer. We have to use our authority. Hallelujah. That means God cannot do anything. Even the Messiah to come, He need a woman, Mother Mary, to say yes. If she would have not said yes, He should be waiting for somebody else to say yes. Otherwise the Messiah cannot come. Thank God for her. That's why He chose her. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. Are you understanding?
Yes.
In the same way, for the devil also to have access, he needs a body. See, now Jesus came, He took a form of the body and He came legally as man. Now when Jesus was in this planet earth, the Bible says Jesus Christ, today we saw, Jesus Christ of Nazareth was filled with the Holy Spirit and He went around doing good. He went around doing good or bad?
Good.
Casting out demons are good or bad?
Good.
Healing the sick was good or bad?
Good.
Thank God, yeah. The Bible says Jesus is the only representation of the Father. And Jesus never went anywhere, laid hand and said, this is my will, be sick. Did He say anywhere? But why do we come with such philosophy? And Jesus is the only representation of the Father. That means Jesus never gave sickness to anybody. That means God will not give sickness to anyone. Jesus came to give us life, life in abundance. But the devil came to kill, steal and destroy. The destroyer is the enemy devil, not God. Jesus never laid His hand on anyone saying, receive sickness. Be sick. My will, I want to teach you lesson. So be sick. Thank God He didn't do that. Just like how God needs a body, somebody. That's why He needs somebody to be a living sacrifice, to give their body so that God can use that body to bring His plan and His purpose into this planet Earth. In the same way, the devil also needs a body so that he can also steal, kill and destroy. That's why he couldn't attack Adam and Eve. He had to come with a lie. He had to come with a deception. And only when Eve believed the lie, agreed the lie, that's when the devil had access. You have a question? Okay, hold on. Let me finish. If you see in 2 Corinthians chapter 4, verse number 4, that scripture says, the God of this world has blinded our minds from receiving the glorious gospel. 2 Corinthians chapter 4, verse number 4.
Yes. Whose minds?
Whose mind?
The God of this age.
The God of this age
has blinded.
Has blinded. The God of some translation says the God of this world. God of this?
World.
Who is the God of this world? Just now I said God gave man dominion. Now you are saying, sorry, not you are saying, the scripture is saying that the God of this world is Satan. And this Satan has blinded our minds. Minds of the unbeliever. Correct? Now, so confusing. God created me like him. Then how did the devil become the God of this world?
Because we gave him authority.
Okay, now, when God gave man dominion, okay, when the devil came with the lie, Romans 6:16 says, to whom I yield myself servants to obey, he becomes my master and I become his slave. So to whom I obey, that person becomes my master and I become his slave. Now when Eve and Adam threw, the devil deceived Adam through Eve, when Adam yielded to the lie, obeyed to the lie, what happened? He became a slave and Satan became the master. Did you understand that?
Yes.
Now when Adam disobeyed God and obeyed the devil, now what happened? Who became the master? The devil became the master. Now that disobedience is called sin. That disobedience is called sin. That means when there is sin in me, I am disobeying God and I'm obeying the lie. That's how, when there is sin in me, the devil has what? Rulership over me. That's how he became the master. And every person who's born from Adam is born with sin nature. We don't become sinners because we commit sin, but we commit sin because we were sinners. Usually we think, okay, if you commit this sin, then you are a sinner, correct? But actually we don't become sinners because we commit sin, just like how Jesus did not commit sin, he was made sin. But in Jesus' case, he became a substitute for us and he took our sin. But in our case, Adam disobeyed. Because Adam disobeyed, there was sin in him. And every person who was born is born with the nature called sin. So when we were born from our mother's womb, we were born with this nature called
sin.
Just like how, anybody have dogs at home? Only two of, okay, Bombay, it's not easy to have dogs. Okay. You have trained your dogs. If you say sit. Sit, run, jump. Oh, well trained. Have you ever trained your dogs not to lick himself, itself? Can you train? No matter how much you train, he will start licking. Correct? Why?
Nature.
In the same way, sin was our nature. No matter how much, you know, if I tell for next 2 minutes, okay, there is something happening behind, nobody should turn back. Nobody should turn back. Now what happened? What is happening inside? I want to see what's happening, right? That's sin nature. When the moment you say don't do, then what comes inside? I want to do. That is rebellious nature. Now this nature did not come from God. That's what happened to Adam, right? Now, this nature, rebellious nature, sin nature, is because we are born with this sin nature, we commit sin. As long as there is sin in us, we are under the dominion of the kingdom of darkness. Every person who is born from his or her mother's womb, by default, is born under the kingdom. Now, the Bible always speaks about kingdom. The kingdom of darkness, the kingdom of, if you, Colossians 1:14, can you read Colossians 1:14?
13, okay. He has delivered us.
He has delivered us.
From the power of darkness.
From the power of darkness.
And conveyed us.
And conveyed us.
Into the kingdom.
Into the kingdom.
Of the Son.
Of the Son.
Of His love.
Of His love. Okay. Now, if you see, when you say kingdom, can you see the word kingdom? Kingdom means there is a king. There is a ruler in a kingdom. Even now also we have some places still kingdom and they have kings, correct? In the same way, the Bible speaks there is two kingdoms. One is the kingdom of darkness and one is the kingdom of light. And in the kingdom of darkness, the devil, that's why the Bible says, even in Ephesians today, we saw in Ephesians 6:12. For we do not wrestle
against flesh and blood.
Against flesh and blood.
But against principalities.
Against powers.
Against the rulers. Of the darkness.
That means there are rulers who are ruling in the kingdom of darkness. That means there are kingdoms. There is a kingdom called the kingdom of darkness, and there is a kingdom called the kingdom of his dear son, the light, the kingdom of light, the kingdom of Christ, the kingdom of God. And when there is a kingdom, there is a king. When there is a kingdom, there is a ruler. That's why Jesus said the God of this world, because there is a kingdom that is ruling this world, and that kingdom is not God's kingdom. That kingdom is the kingdom of darkness that is ruling. That's why the system of this world is not the system of God. That's why the Bible says, do not be conformed to this world, because the world has a system that is the system of kingdom of darkness. So every person who is born from his or her mother's womb is born under, by default, under the kingdom of darkness, where the devil was the ruler that was ruling over you and me. Because of sin, the devil had legal right over my life. That's how the devil became the God of this world. Thank you, Jesus.
Thank you.
But the good news is, sin is no longer an issue. You know why? Can you take 2 Corinthians 5:21.
For he made him
who
knew no sin.
He is God the Father. For God the Father made him is Jesus. For God the Father made Jesus to be sin.
For us.
That we might
become
the righteousness.
Of God
in him. Now listen to this. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. Praise you, Jesus. All those who are sleeping say hallelujah.
Hallelujah. We are waking them.
Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
All those who are sleeping say hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
All those who are awake say hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
Praise God. Thank you, Jesus. Okay, there's something important. That's why I have to wake you. 2 Corinthians 5:21 says, Jesus who knew no sin. That means he was not born with sin nature like how everybody else were born. Because he was not born from the seed of a man. He was born by through a virgin, through the power of the Holy Spirit. Now, Jesus was not born with sin nature, nor he was just like the first Adam. But when the first Adam was tempted, he disobeyed. Jesus also was tempted like everybody, but he never disobeyed. He never committed a single sin. The Bible speaks about two kind of righteousness. Who is a righteous person?
Right standing with God.
Okay. Now, who can have right standing with God?
Those who have a relationship with him.
Okay. According to the old covenant, when a person keeps all the laws, then he is a perfect person who has never committed any sin, and that person has right standing with God. Before Jesus, did anybody keep all the law?
No.
In fact, nobody can keep the law. That's why Jesus came. Jesus did not come to break the law. He came to fulfill the law. And Jesus is the only person. That's why he is God, but he came as man, not as God. And he kept all the law. That's why he is sinless. He was without sin because he kept all the law. Who's a sinner? Who broke the law?
Yes.
Correct? Is there anybody who kept all the law? If you say yes, then you are the biggest sinner. Now, Jesus is the only person who kept all the law. That means Jesus is righteous by his action. He is righteous and he has right standing with the Father because of what he did. What he did, he kept all the... But the problem with you and me is the law is good, the law is perfect, but we had sin nature, we did not have the power to keep the law. And none of us have right standing with God based on our works or based on our action or based on our good works. Because if you don't understand righteousness, then you don't understand authority. Then that's why today he was saying, your authority is not based on your good works. But somehow, if I connect my authority with how good I am, how holy I am, that's why we don't go out to lay hand on the sick, because we see our own life and we say, I'm disqualified. I don't mind going very slow. But I am going to give you a big pause, not for you to sleep, but for you to think. Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
If you understand this, then it changes your whole life. Now, Jesus, many a time we misunderstand law. When I say law, I'm speaking about the law of Moses. The law of Moses, the summary of the law of Moses is the Ten Commandments, correct? Somehow it is ingrained in us that I have to keep this law. If I keep this law, then I'm good. When I'm good, then I can see more power. Correct? So for me to see answers for my prayer is hidden in keeping the law. This is our mindset. If that is the mindset, nobody can see the power of God manifest. Only Jesus can see, because he is the only person who had the power and who was sinless and who kept all the law. Okay, can you read Romans 10 verse number 3?
For they being ignorant
of God's righteousness
and seeking to establish
their own righteousness
have not submitted to the righteousness of God.
Okay, I'm going to read this again next three times. Okay, shall I?
Yes, you can.
What translation is that?
NKJV.
Okay, can you take AMP? Okay, NRSV. Before that, you can take, I'll take that also. The reason I'm going to read this again and again so that you don't miss. For being ignorant of the righteousness that comes from God and seeking to establish their own, they have not submitted to God's righteousness. For being ignorant of the righteousness that comes from God and seeking to establish their own, they have not submitted to God's righteousness. You got? By the time take AMP, AMPC. For they being ignorant of God's righteousness and going about to establish their own righteousness have not submitted themselves unto the righteousness of God. Now there are two righteousness. One is
self-righteousness and one is God's righteousness. Is it clear? There is two righteousness. For they being ignorant of God's righteousness. Are we ignorant of God's righteousness? Yes, that's why we don't see our prayers are powerful. Because the prayer of the righteous is powerful. The reason why we don't use authority and see result, because we are trying to walk in our own righteousness, which we are not supposed to. Now, when I say own righteousness, I'm trying to earn God's favor based on my good works. So I'm not supposed to live good. No, I did not say that. I'll explain. I'll come there. Okay, I'll come there. For they being ignorant of God's righteousness and going about to establish their own righteousness, have not submitted themselves unto the righteousness of God. Praise God. Hallelujah. So that means there is two righteousness. One righteousness comes, that is self-righteousness, and the other righteousness is God's righteousness. Okay. For not knowing about God's righteousness, which is based on faith, and seeking to establish their own righteousness based on works. So God's righteousness is based on faith. Self-righteousness is based on works. For not knowing about God's righteousness, which is based on faith, and seeking to establish their own righteousness, it's gone. And seeking to establish their own righteousness based on works, they did not submit to God's righteousness. In 2 Corinthians 5:21, we already saw, you don't take, you just listen. God the Father made Jesus to be sin, who knew
no sin,
so that you and I will be made righteousness. Just like how Jesus, who never committed sin, was made sin, in the same way you and I, who never lived righteous, are made righteous, not because of what we do, but because of what Jesus did for us. And all that we have to do is to believe. That's why it says it is based on faith. That's why what pleases God? Faith pleases God. Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
Thank you, Jesus. Shaking your philosophy?
Heavy?
Heavy
to digest.
Heavy to digest? It's not heavy. It's simple. Why? What makes us heavy is, he said, right, the second unbelief, the wrong, you know, I recently heard somebody giving this example. When a board is fully written, can you write anything on that?
No.
That's why you're feeling heavy. Mm-hmm. There is already a mindset of self-righteousness. There is already a mindset of performance. There is already a mindset I have to do to get. Now, when I try to teach you on God's righteousness, there is already written so much and there is something else to be written. That's why it's heavy. Instead of writing on what is already written, it's time for us to rub the board. That means undoing, unlearning is very important. That's why the most difficult unbelief to deal is disbelief. That is, the first unbelief is the person is ignorant, very easy. That's why when non-Christians come, very easy, because they don't know anything. And that's why they see instant answers. They don't see instant answer because sometimes we feel, why they are seeing instant answer? The difference is they are quick to believe, that's all. We have so many philosophy, I have to pray this many hours, I have to fast this, I have to do this, I have to do. We have so, that's why we don't see answer and we think, why God is answering them, not us. Because we are not dealing with the first kind of unbelief, we are dealing with the second kind of unbelief, that is having wrong knowledge. Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
And the third kind of unbelief is unbelief where the person knows the truth, but the person seeing the problem, seeing the physical symptom more real than what the word of God says,
The third unbelief is because the person's heart is hardened. Thank you, Jesus. Okay, let's come back to righteousness. She said it's very heavy, so let me explain again. Yeah. Praise God. Unlearning. Okay, now listen. Whenever you see this word self-righteous, okay, can you read Philippians chapter 3, verse number 9? Hallelujah. Okay, now these are the words of Paul. You know who Paul was? Who was Saul? He was persecuting the church. He gave tough time. Yes or no?
Yes.
Even the disciples were scared of him. Even when God told Ananias, he was like, what? Why? Because he will not spare them. Correct? Now, why he was so angry with the Christians, the disciples of Jesus? Why was he persecuting the church, putting them in prison and you know, murdering them? Why? Because? Only because I can hear. Because. After that? What? It's the right thing. Why did he think it's the right thing? You know why? He also had our kind of mindset. Because if you keep the law, you're good. If you don't keep the law, you're bad. Very simple. And he's a scholar. And he knows the law very well. And these Christians are saying, even if you're a sinner, no problem. You just believe and you're made righteous. And he saw them, how, you know, blaspheming and coming against the law of God. But thank God, he himself became the foundation of grace. And he began to preach the gospel of grace. Paul, who was Saul, he was persecuting the church not because he was a bad man. According to him, he's doing good. These people are destroying, blaspheming God, coming against the law and telling that, you know, if you're under law, you are under curse. And if you're set free from the law, you're forgiven, you're washed by the blood of Jesus. The sinners and the prostitutes and the tax collectors are calling themselves saints now. Now, see the same Paul who encountered, when he was Saul, he encountered Christ. And after his life changed, see his own words. Now, why was he angry with them? Because according to him, he kept the law. He lived much holy life. I'll read from 5th verse. Okay? I'll read from 5th verse. Even if you don't read, no problem. Listen. Philippians chapter 3 from verse number 5. Circumcised the 8th day. You know what he's saying? I am a Pharisee. And I kept the law so much perfect that even my circumcision was, I was 8 on the 8th day. Circumcised the 8th day of the stock of Israel, of the tribe of Benjamin, a Hebrew of the Hebrews. Who's he? I'm a Hebrew of a Hebrews concerning the law, a Pharisee concerning zeal, persecuting the church. So he was zealous that he kept the law, and he's a Pharisee and he's a Hebrew of the Hebrew. Because of that reason, he was persecuting the church. He was not a, you know, thief or robber or persecuting the church. He was a godly man who kept the law. That's why he was persecuting the church. Concerning zeal, persecuting the church, concerning the righteousness which is in the law, blameless. Why he was persecuting? Because he saw himself, according to the law, I am righteous and I am blameless. If these people who are sinners are called righteous, then what about me who lived holy? Yes or no? See, that's his question. These people are sinners and they are calling themselves righteous. I have kept the law and I am blameless and I am righteous. Now you know why he persecuted the church? Hallelujah. The persecution doesn't come from outside. The persecution comes when the scriptures are misinterpreted. He persecuted the church because he himself is a scholar and he knew the scripture and he misinterpreted the scripture. And when there is misinterpretation of the scripture, that's when comes disbelief. Hallelujah. But Paul himself says, I did not believe because I was ignorant. Means I was ignorant of the gospel of grace. Hallelujah. Okay, concerning righteousness, which is in the law, blameless. But what things ever gained to me, these I counted loss for Christ. Now all this knowledge I have, I counted loss for Christ. Yet indeed I also count all things lost for the excellence of the knowledge of Christ Jesus my Lord, for whom I have suffered the loss of all things and count them as rubbish. All that knowledge what he had, he's saying what? They are rubbish. That I, in comparison of what he has in Christ, he's saying it's rubbish, that I may gain Christ and be found. Now listen to this. This is exactly what I want to show you. And be found in him, not having my own righteousness. Now, and be found in him. Now, because I am in Christ, just before two verses he said, I am righteous because I kept the law. But now he's saying, because now I am in Christ and be found in him, not having my own righteousness, which is from the law, but that which is through faith in Christ, the righteousness which is from God by faith. He himself who kept all the law, according to him, he realized that he did not keep. Nobody, if anybody says I kept all the law, he's a liar. Who thought who was blameless because he kept all the law, he himself comes to a realization, I am righteous not based on the law because I kept the Ten Commandments or I kept the Moses law, but I am now righteous by faith, not by keeping the law. When I was born from my mother's womb, I was born with sin nature. But when the gospel was preached, and the gospel is not about what I do, the gospel is what Jesus did for me on the cross. His death and resurrection. Correct? Now, when the gospel is preached, Jesus who knew no sin is made sin, and Jesus became a substitute and he took my sin. And when I believe in what Jesus did for me, that very moment I am born again. Just like how you and I were born from our mother's womb, we were born with sin nature, now we are born again, and now we are born again from our father's womb. And now when I'm born again, I have the very nature of God. I am instantly made the righteousness of God in Christ Jesus. That's why Paul is saying, I am not righteous by law, but I am righteous by faith in Christ. That's why Paul says, I am what I am. It's not because of what I did, but I am what I am is by the grace of God. My identity, that's why he was telling, if I want to operate in authority, I first have to understand my identity. My identity of who I am or what I am is not based on my action, but my identity is based on who am I. Hallelujah. You know what is the good news is? Just like how when I was born from my mother's womb, there was sin nature in me. That's why I was living in sin. When I was born again, now I have God's nature in me. That is called righteousness. Now because I am made righteous, it's not just I'm made righteous. The very nature of God is put inside of me. In the old covenant, the law demanded, but I did not have the power to do what the law demanded. But in the new covenant, God has changed my heart. God has changed my spirit, and God has put
He has taken that old nature of sin and he has put the new nature, that's God's very nature in me. Now I have God's ability to live righteous. In the new covenant, the change is not in the change of action, but in the new covenant, the change is in the change of my thinking. When my thinking changes, my action changes by default. Many a times, the challenge for us to go out and lay hand on the sick or cast out demons or pray for the sick or open blind eyes is we are trying to live under self-righteousness. Even though we don't use the term self-righteous, we have the mindset of self-righteous. That's why you ask the question, when there is sin, then I feel like, you know, I'm not good enough, I'm not holy enough, I'm not perfect enough. How, you know, I have to deal with that first. The problem is, my identity is based on who I am already. But you are seeing yourself, your identity based on your action. Let me give an example. Have you seen your face? Have you seen your face anytime? What question? Today also I saw. Okay, did you see your face or did you see the reflection of your face? Nobody eyes came out, popped and turned, and nobody. Can you imagine? None of us have ever seen our face at all. None of us have seen our face. Others have seen our face, but we have not seen our face. Yes or no? But when we look into the mirror, that mirror is showing how my face looks, correct?
Yes.
That is a reflection of how I look. Yes or no?
Yes.
In the same way, what you see in the mirror is not you. What you see in the mirror is your body. Is a house where you stay. That's not you. You are who you are in Christ. That's why Paul said, I am what I am is by the grace of God. Ephesians chapter 2 from verse number 8 onwards. For it is by free grace, God's unmerited favor, that you are saved, delivered from judgment and made partakers of Christ's salvation through your faith. I'll read again, listen. How are we saved? For it is by free grace, God's unmerited favor. So did we merit? Did we earn? Did we keep the law? No. Unmerited favor, that you are saved, delivered from judgment and made partakers of Christ's salvation through your faith. And this salvation is not of yourselves, of your own doing. It came not through your own striving, but it is the gift of God. Not because of works. Did I receive the salvation because I kept the law? No. Not because of works, not the fulfillment of the law's demands, lest any man should boast. It is not the result of what anyone can possibly do. So no one can pride himself in it or take glory of himself. Did anybody receive salvation by keeping the law? By the good works? No. That means nobody can take pride or nobody can take glory saying, because I lived good, because I did not even take a cigarette, I did not commit adultery, I went to church every day, I did confession every day four times. None of those things which you think you did will qualify you. I'm not saying the word of God says. Yes or no?
Yes.
But the mindset, all these things qualify me, is a mindset called self-righteousness. I am righteous because I did all. I am right. I have right standing with God because today I went for confession. I have right standing with God because I go to church every day. I have right standing with God because I did not commit adultery. I have right standing with God because I did not rob. That is called having a mindset of self-righteousness. That means I have right standing with God based on what I did. And the biggest sin is self-righteousness. Because every other sin the person realizes that he is a sinner. Okay, let me give an example. Okay, long time since I gave this example. I used to give this example. It's not in the Bible. My own example. Some of you would have heard also. Have you heard high-class demon, low-class demon? Who heard? Somebody said yes. Michael heard. You have heard. Okay. 2-3 of them heard. Okay. I used to say high-class demon and low-class demon. But the reason why I came with that kind of terminology is, in the time of Jesus, the so-called sinners, a man who had 2,000 demons, the woman who had demons, Jesus would cast out and they would manifest, they would scream, they would roll. Correct? Everybody knows there is a demon. Everybody knows this man is chained. Everybody knows there are demons in. Yes or no?
Yes.
When a tax collector or a prostitute, they know that they are wrong, they are sinners. I would call them, they are very low class demons. You know why? Because the one who has also knows they have, and everybody knows they have demon. And when they cast out, no, they make so much noise. But the high class demons, that's what Jesus said in James chapter 3 verse number 16, when there is strife and there is enmity. He did not say where there is adultery and where there is theft and when there is murder. He said where there is jealousy, where there is strife, where there is pride, it is sensual, it is devilish, it is earthly, and there is all evil work. Now, when it comes to the Pharisees, not all Pharisees, but most of the Pharisees, they were not in prostitution or they were not in murdering. That's why they would say, discuss, you know, when the woman was washing Jesus' feet, they're discussing, Jesus doesn't know, she's a sinner. Now, that means what? She's a sinner, we are all righteous. Correct? Yes or no?
Yes.
Now, why do you think they always say, look at Jesus, he always sits with these sinners? That means what? They are sinners. I am?
Righteous.
But what about the elder son? My younger son is, my younger brother is sinner. I am?
Righteous.
But the Bible says the one who hates his brother is a murderer. Did he love his brother or hate his brother? The Pharisees loved, Jesus said he loves the sinner and hates the sin. Did the Pharisees love them or hated them? Was there strife? Was there hatred? Was there unforgiveness? Was there pride? Was there glory? Even Jesus said when the Pharisees would come, they would take the first seat and sit. They would, you know, exalt themselves. Yes or no?
Yes.
That is high class demon. You know why high class demon? First of all, they don't know there are demons in. And these demons reside in the holy place, in the synagogue, in the place of God. And these people who have these demons are the ministers of the scriptures. Such high class demon, they don't scream and yell and shout and roll on the floor. They're so sophisticated demons. They deceive the person also and they deceive others also. Oh, he's a very holy man. Very dangerous. The low class demons are not so dangerous. It's easy. Identifying also easy. Casting out also easy. Repentance also is easy. Forgiveness also easy. That's why the sinners easily accepted the Messiah. But the Pharisees came against him. Today also same story. That's why self-righteousness is the dangerous sin. And I would call those demons as high class demons. And these demons are dealt inside the church, not outside. Outside are small demons, easily dealt. Because the person will never realize that I need a Messiah, I'm not perfect. Because the person is always trying to have right standing with God based on how good I am. Remember there is a parable Jesus gave, a Pharisee and the publican.
And the Pharisee said, look at me, I fast two times in a day, I go to the temple every day, I do not do this, I do not look at the publican. And where is the publican? Outside the synagogue. And he's crying, God, I'm a sinner. And the Bible says God called him righteous. And this one, no. Righteous is not based on action. Abraham was not righteous. If you see Romans chapter 4, the Bible says, Abraham, do you think Abraham is righteous because he kept the law? No. Even in the old covenant, nobody was righteous by keeping the law. I'll read for you. Can you Romans chapter 4, verse number 1 onwards.
Yes.
Can you take an AMP? What then shall we say that Abraham our father had found according to the flesh? For if Abraham was justified by works, that is, if he was justified by the law, he has something to boast about, but not before God. For what does the scripture say? Abraham believed God and it was counted to him for righteousness. Was Abraham righteous because he kept the law? No. Even in the old covenant, nobody was righteous because they kept the law. If they have to be righteous by keeping the law, other than Jesus, nobody can be righteous. Thank God for that. God introduced us another righteousness, not by works, but by faith. Okay, I'll read in AMP. It will be more elaborated. But if so, what shall we say about Abraham, our forefather? Humanly speaking, what did he find out? How does this affect his position and what was gained by him? For if Abraham was justified, established as just by acquittal from guilt by good works that he did, then he has grounds for boasting, but not before God. For what does the scripture say? Abraham believed in, trusted in God, and it was credited to his account as righteousness, right living, and right standing with God. So was Abraham righteous because he kept the law? No. Because he did all these things? No. Maybe we may not say 10 commandments, but when we have a mindset, when we have Ephesians, take Ephesians 2:8 onwards. Okay. Now, Abraham did not keep all the law. In fact, the law was not there at the time of Abraham. But he was righteous because he believed in the promise. You know what is believing in the promise? Whenever the word promise, it speaks about what God did. Promise doesn't speak about what I do. Promise speaks about what God do. If you see the Bible, there are two things. One is the law and one is the promise. Which came first? Promise came or law came? Promise came first. God gave Abraham the law, a promise first. Law came later on in the wilderness. That means what came first? Grace came first. Because the promise doesn't speak about what you have to perform. It speaks about what God has already performed. God promised Abraham, I have made you the father of many nations. It's not about what Abraham has to do. It's about what God has done. I have blessed you. All that Abraham has to do is to believe. And because he believed, he was called righteous. So Abraham was not righteous because he kept the law, but he was righteous because he believed. You know why we commit sin? Because we don't believe. That's why I told you, I'll come to that point. Can I live in sin? Me living in sin is a proof that I have not believed. So the solution is not about how holy I live. The solution is about believing in what Jesus did. My focus should not be on what I have to do. My focus should be on believing in what he has done. Why you think when you see a demon manifesting, you fear? Because you don't know your identity. Who you are. I told you in the beginning, without a body, the earth suit, nobody has access in this planet Earth.
Now, God, for even God to have access in this earth, he took a form of a body. And he had to come, he had to come through Mother Mary, and Mother Mary had to agree for Jesus to come into this planet Earth. Correct? In the same way, the devil also, how did he become the master? Because somebody gave his or her body. I would say the pigs were smarter than us. When Jesus cast the demons, they chose not to give their body and they committed suicide. Because the demons cannot have access in this earth without a body. That's why they are seeking for a house. Even a small cockroach, a small ant has a body. Correct? That means that cockroach is more powerful than the demon. Because the demons have no... That's why they are looking whom they can deceive so that they will give access so that he can use that body. I'm not saying there are some things happening in the kingdom of darkness. I remember an example. I think Papa gave this example. So somewhere they were telling, you know, the spoon would move, the plates would move. Immediately Papa said, that's all. All power you have to move the spoon from here to here. But look at me, I can take the spoon, I can put in the food, I can eat my food also. Can you do? You're so powerless, you can't even do that. See, that's how you have understanding. When you see small things like something moving here, something moving there, you're scared. But what about the power in you to even raise the dead? What about the power in you to open the blind eyes? The power in you to cast out demons? That's why he said, morning, the devil knew the power you have better than you know the power you have. He's showing some drama, and the drama also, that's all he could do. He cannot do more than that. And you're scared of the drama? Actually, it is your fear that he's taking advantage. That's why Jesus never allowed any drama. He said, keep quiet and get out. But we don't even say keep quiet. We allow the demon to do all drama. And then, you know, running here and there and shouting and screaming. And now the demon understood. The moment you operate in fear, that's when you open door for the demon to attack you. Without fear, the devil has no power over you. And why you are having fear? Because those seeds are being planted in your heart. You have, you know, the dangerous thing is to have more knowledge about all these things. We have so much knowledge. It's the second unbelief, the disbelief is wrong knowledge. Now, why is that fear coming? Because you have watched in horror movies, you have heard people saying the demon will come on you. You have people having stories telling, you know, they went and laid hand and they attacked and blood came and this came and that came. You have so much stories of how powerful the demon is, but you don't have enough truth of how powerful God who is in you. Hallelujah. It's not just having knowledge. Okay, I'll explain to you what I'm saying. I see people who are more demon conscious have more demonic problem. Some people, they have ministry only, casting a demon, doing deliverance, and all that they do is casting a demon. Day and night they think about demon and they keep naming this, the name of this demon is this, God showed me this demon, God showed me that demon, and this demon, and this demon does that, and yeah, whatever it is. And you see their life is miserable. You know why? They're all the time thinking about demon and they're speaking about how the demon would manifest and naming the demon and this demon comes upon me. That's why you're operating in fear. You can come to a place where every day you start feeding yourself with who Jesus is, who you are in Jesus, and you begin to see the Creator, the light that is in Him. And the Bible says, in the beginning was the Word was with Him, and the Word was God, and that Word is the light, and when the light shines, the darkness cannot overcome the light. And when you begin to see how when Jesus came into a place, the Creator who created the heavens and the earth, when He walked into the demons, were even telling, your time has not come, why are you here? They were so scared of Him.
in His presence. And when you are so conscious of who you are born again. His spirit and your spirit is one. The Creator Himself is residing. And every day you remind yourself, you see who you are, you rehearsal who you are, you speak who you are, and you see the same light is in you. You see the same Jesus in you. When you walk into a place, now you're not seeing the demon. You are scared of demon, but you are seeing the demon is scared of not you, but Christ in you. You can actually come to a place where you don't have fear, because you see that creature as a creature who's powerless, who has lost his power, where Jesus disarmed him on the cross. And now I have authority because I am righteous and I have right standing with God. And now I have right standing with God, not because of what I did, because I believe in what Jesus did. And now I have his very nature in him and I have the right standing with God. That's why I say in the name of Jesus, it's not because of the works I did, but because of the works that Jesus did for me on the cross. And when I say in Jesus' name, the devil cannot bring my history or my past, because my past and my history is named on the cross and is washed by the blood of Jesus. And now in Jesus' name, when I speak to that demon has to leave.
Amen.
Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
But when do you think you speak with such boldness? Only when you know who you are. You are not based on what you did a few minutes ago or a few hours ago. You are what God made you to be. And when you begin to renew your mind every day, knowing your identity, your action by default, that's why the Bible says the grace of God teaches me to deny ungodliness. That's why he said, Christian life is not about living a perfect life, but Christian life is a constant realization that it is not what I did, but what he did, and constantly tapping into his power, his ability, which I don't deserve, and that is God's power and that is God's grace. I want to show one incident in the Bible, okay, and then we will close. Okay, I will read. Can you give me Acts chapter 3, verse number 1 onwards? You know, in Mark 11, 22, 23, we see Peter being so astonished. Wow, Jesus. He also asked today, right? If he asked, right?
Yeah.
How he would have asked, correct?
Yes.
How did he ask?
How did
how? It was a question, right? Peter was so astonished. He was so amazed that Jesus only spoke a word and this tree is died from the root. Yes or no?
Yes.
And he was so amazed and he was so astonished. But Peter did not, you know, we are like Peter now. But Peter did not remain in the same condition. Now Peter also is doing, because Jesus said, anyone, whosoever believes. Did he say believes or keep the law?
Yes.
Thank God, yeah. These signs will follow those who believe or those who keep the law? How come we miss it? Because the mindset is tuned with wrong teaching, so much so. And that's why we don't see the power of God manifest. Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
Now the same Peter who was so astonished and so amazed at looking at Jesus, he just spoke the word and in 24 hours the tree died, and Jesus gave him and taught him that whoever believes, when you speak to this mountain, be uprooted and be cast into the sea, without doubting in his heart, he shall have whatever he says. Now the same Peter, after the resurrection of Jesus, after the Pentecost, now Peter and John went up together to the temple at the hour of prayer, the ninth hour, and a certain man lame from his mother's womb carried, whom they laid daily at the gate of the temple, which is called Beautiful, to ask alms from those who entered the temple, who, seeing Peter and John about to go into the temple, asked for alms. And fixing his eyes on him with John, Peter said, look at
us. Look at
us.
Look at
us.
Praise God. You know, there are small things you can learn. There are times you also go and tell a person, look at me. And when you are saying, look at me, okay, it is not you, but Christ in you. But you have to believe. That's how you use your authority. Look at us. So he gave them his attention, expecting to receive something from them. That means there is a kind of cooperation from that man also. He also was responding, and he was also expecting something. That much faith is enough to see the glory of God. Do you think the crippled man was a believer for a long time in the world? No. Sometimes when we go and minister, we expect the person to be more strong than us in the faith. Praise God. That much the person being ready to agree is enough. So he gave them his attention, expecting to receive something from them. Then Peter said, silver and gold I do not have, but what I do have, I give you. What they had? They had the power of God. What they had? They had authority. Now, what is authority? Authority is when I have the right to use God's power. I have the right in the name of Jesus to use his power. Authority is the right to command. But what I do have, I give you in the name of Jesus Christ of Nazareth. Hallelujah. Is it by my works? Is it by my holiness? Is it because I prayed? Or is it because of what Jesus did and in his name? In the name of Jesus Christ of Nazareth, Father, please heal him. Lord, please touch him. Lord, please deliver him. Today, you know, I am only revising what you learned in the morning. Okay, today he said, God will never do what he told you to do. God told you and me to speak to the mountain. What are we telling God to speak to? Did Peter ask God, please heal him? Did he say, Lord, please touch him? Lord, please, now, Lord, thank you, Jesus, Abba, Father. Did he make so many big, big prayers? Or did he use his authority? What are we doing? When we see somebody with demon, Lord, Jesus, touch him, Lord, with your Holy Spirit, Lord. Fill, Lord, fill, Lord, fill, Lord, fire, Lord, fire, Lord. Yes or no? Exact words? In your laugh, I could understand. You know why we do that? Because for us, we use authority based on our righteousness. We have not understood the authority because we have not understood our identity. Did he speak to the crippled man?
Yes.
That comes as a result. Now, you know, in Mark 11, there are two words. One is pray and one is say. Praying is my communion, my relationship, where I knowing God and knowing who I am in Christ. And Peter knew who his identity, that he is righteous, not because of what he did, but he is righteous because of what Jesus did. And now because he knew his identity, the identity comes. Because he knows his identity, that's when comes the confidence. If you ask me, how are you confident? If my confidence was based on my performance, I fail miserably. My confidence is not because of what I perform. My confidence is because of what Jesus performs. In the name of Jesus Christ of Nazareth, rise up and walk. Did he walk? Did he speak? First is authority? Yes. But did anything happen in the physical? No. Whenever we use our authority, we speak. The problem is we want to see. But when you use your authority and when you speak, you don't wait to see, you begin to act. For example, you have pain in your legs, you command your pain to leave. Now don't check whether the pain is gone. Start moving your leg and start walking, believing it's gone. Act based on what you spoke. Now when Peter and John spoke to the crippled man, rise up and walk. Do you think he got up and he began to walk? No. If you see, in the name of Jesus Christ of Nazareth, rise up and walk. And he took him by the right hand and lifted him up. Can you see that? Nothing happened. Even though they spoke, rise up and walk, nothing happened.